Within the past 10 years, Alaska's fertile horizons have taken on a new look. Where forests stood a few years ago, barley fields and dairy farms have been carved into the wilderness. More than 150,000 acres of state-owned land has been released to private ownership by the state since 1978. The state has spent, by some estimates, more than $100 million to create the basis for an agricultural industry. This massive state-financed development is designed to enable Alaskans, who must import 95% of their food, to be largely self-sufficient in the production of meat, eggs, and milk by 1990. But in spite of the state's plan and financial support, Alaskan farmers are far behind the production goals set by the state when the farm program began 7 years ago. Many Alaskan farms are in serious financial condition, with no cash reserves, few markets, and concern that the state may not come to their rescue. Farmers now talk not of success, but of survival down on the farm.
Right now, the producers are being forced into a situation that they cannot continue to sustain.
Because when families start to be jeopardized, that's when you have to get your priorities in order. And that's the point we're at now in Delta.
A lot of people like to live in the Matanuska Valley because of the rural atmosphere, but that very thing is destroying it.
The Matanuska Valley, 40 miles from Anchorage, has been Alaska's agricultural center for half a century. But with land being taken out of production for housing and shopping centers, this is no longer the rural farm area it once was. During the depression that gripped the nation in the 1930s, the federal government sponsored the colonization of the Matanuska Valley. The idea behind the colony was to see if farmers from the Midwest could transplant their knowledge and experience to Alaska's less hospitable environment. Land was provided at low cost. A railroad linked the colony with the growing city of Anchorage. Within 10 years, the colony had expanded agricultural production from a subsistence to a commercial stage based on dairy farming and vegetable production. By the 1960s, the Matanuska Valley farmers provided a large share of the fresh farm products consumed in the Anchorage area. But at the moment it seemed that commercial agriculture had taken firm root as an industry in Alaska, the economics of local farm production changed as the face of Alaska changed with the discovery of oil. An oil strike at Swanson River in 1957 and the massive oil find at Prudhoe Bay 11 years later was the beginning of Alaska's oil-based economy. Oil production led to an increase in population, and with growth came a corresponding increase in shipping from West Coast ports and lower freight rates. Grocery retailers found they could import a relatively constant supply of farm products at prices lower than local farmers could produce them. Imported fresh food products dealt a severe blow to Alaskan farmers and marked the beginning of the decline in local farm production.
What happened were some tremendous improvements in the efficiency of the transportation system. First, Sealand and later Tote and others began to provide us with container service and roll-on, roll-off service, which made it possible to import dairy products, beef, eggs, all the foodstuffs by surface freight. Before that, it had been by air freight if you wanted to get anything that matched, that had any kind of quality to it. As soon as that happened, the decline of Alaskan agriculture began.
A new era in Alaska's agriculture was inaugurated in 1978. The state treasury was beginning to bulge with revenue from North Slope oil production. Governor Jay Hammond had been elected to a second term with a pledge to bolster the state's renewable resource industry, and agriculture was high on his list.
I had watched the problems that had confronted the industry over the years. I'd watched, for example, years ago before statehood, the number of dairy farms and people who raise poultry and what have you gradually fade out of business simply because they could not compete with importations from elsewhere. And so when people came to me who had a vital interest in enhancing or expanding agricultural potential in the state, suggested that there were certain avenues and approaches that might be taken to foster agriculture and ultimately provide for a viable industry that could sustain us and reduce that dependency upon imported foodstuffs, I perked up my ears. But I knew from the very beginning that it would be absolutely crucial to forge the entire chain rather than a link at a time and then stop in the middle of it if you were going to have something that gave it a good college try and prove conclusively one way or another whether or not agriculture was viable in the state.
The man charged with forging the links was Bob Palmer, a former state senator and Kenai Peninsula farmer. The first link in the chain was the 60,000-acre Delta Barley Project. In this 1979 interview, Palmer explained the idea behind the project.
Yet, again, there is not nearly enough local consumption or local demand for the production of 50,000 acres, so we had to get costs down low enough that we could sell on the international market. For that reason, though local consumption is our number one priority, and developing a red meat industry to utilize that local consumption, right from the very beginning, we had to be able to have an international market, in this case it's Japan and Taiwan, to take that surplus so that we could justify the whole product, the whole project, and have a sale for all that was produced.
It was against this backdrop of resolve and seemingly unlimited financial resources that the administration's ambitious agricultural policy was set in motion. The direction that policy took drew criticism from several corners. One of those was Vic Fisher, now a state senator.
Interestingly, at the time when Bob Palmer and company came up with the Delta scheme, Department of Natural Resources was doing a plan for the Delta area, a land use plan, in cooperation with the people residing in Delta. That plan did not indicate anything of the in the direction or the magnitude of a Delta agricultural project. Palmer and Company bulldozed their way right into the planning process, pushed that aside, and says it will go, it will be so. There were agricultural economists who questioned the viability of that undertaking right from the start. They were not listened to. They were shoved aside, or they were told to change their recommendations. Only the words of those who said, yes, sir, this is a great idea. Agriculture will make the tundra bloom or whatever. Only those were listened to because they hewed the party line.
By the end of 1981, an additional 24,000 acres was added to the Delta project for a total of 74,000 acres. But by 1982, Delta farmers had harvested less than 8,000 acres of barley. Bad weather, delays in getting land into production, and the fact that the all-important international market never materialized dashed all hope that Hammond's agricultural plan of 1978 would work.
It was debated in many quarters whether it was a prudent investment or otherwise, but again, when I saw enormous subsidies being expended for all sorts of other activities in the state that I felt were perhaps less viable, it appeared to me that this was worthy of some assistance from the state, given the enormous amount of oil wealth we had in place. I am, disappointed that there was not a continuation, a completion of that chain linkage that included, of course, holding facilities and potentially export facilities in the form of the grain terminal at Seward.
At the bottom of the tangle of unfortunate circumstances are the Delta farmers. They feel they are not only the victims of bad weather and changing markets, but victims of the ambitious dreams of state government as well. Jerry Bremer was one of the first Delta Project farmers.
One thing that enticed me to get into the program in the first place was the state was continually publishing production pamphlets where they were saying they were achieving, let's say, in excess of 2 tons of the acre average yields. And when we got started and get into the real life situation, the yields or the production averages weren't quite as high as the state had been telling everyone. The state was going to, they made statements that they were going to try and provide markets. They were going to build country elevators, provide, maintain road systems, provide power, communications, and generally assist everybody in every way they can to make the farming whole system work, including infrastructure and export facilities, the whole bit. And some of those things haven't quite happened on schedule as they had originally planned.
What has that all meant to you in terms of you invested your life and your money into this project, and what has the...
What's happened to me personally, yeah. I don't know. Since 1978, my financial statement looks very bleak. I've been divorced, you know what, and I would say that we're just about down and out. I personally am, anyway.
Most of the barley farmers are in economic trouble, and while they say they haven't given up, time is running out. Delta farmer Charlie Trowbridge says it's time for the state to get the agricultural program back on track.
I think it gets down to one point where you have to look at things realistically. If we can't get the plan online immediately to where we know where we're at in the direction we're going in, no, I won't. I won't even attempt to hold out at this point. I'm not going to jeopardize my family to do that. You know, I can turn right around and go back in the States and start right back over again out there and come out of the thing. You know?
One Delta farmer who prefers growing grass seed rather than barley is Barney Hollembaek. He blames the barley project's difficulties on both farmers and the state administration.
They knocked out the Seward export facility. That hurt desperately. You have no export facility at Valdez. As far as the project's concerned, there has been some farmers come and go, and there always is. That don't shock me too much. There's good farmers and there's bad farmers, and circumstances at the time may make you a good farmer or a bad farmer. If you get caught and make the wrong guess in the fall of the year and wait too long to combine, you're going to get caught with your crop in the field. And you're not a success that year for sure. I think the biggest problem in Alaska is that the state does not have a policy on agriculture. It's just fragmented. We can go in there, I was on the ag task force, and we made a plan, but there's no reason that the state will ever follow this plan. And I feel that fragmentation just is not helping anything. You've got to get a plan, you've got to stick with it. And you have to implement the things that take to make a success of farming. You can raise the crop here. What are you going to do with it after you raise it?
The perceived lack of a clear, concise plan and a thorough marketing system for agriculture is at the heart of most criticism leveled at the Division of Agriculture today, along with concern about the price Alaskans are paying for development projects.
Well, I've been extremely concerned about the tremendous amount of subsidies that the state is pouring into agriculture without a real plan and without any real understanding of the economics of agriculture now and in the future. We essentially are producing probably no more than 5% of the foodstuffs consumed in Alaska, and the investment that we're making does not appear to significantly increase the percentage of food production in Alaska. We essentially are putting into agriculture something like $10 for every dollar, 10 state dollars for every dollar of gross product in the area of agriculture. It's a phenomenal ratio of subsidy, and agriculture obviously isn't standing on its own feet, and all of the projections so far indicate that we're going to be subsidizing it at a very high rate into the future.
But Bill Heim, director of the Division of Agriculture, doesn't agree that massive subsidies will be needed.
we don't need to put that much money into agriculture. We've got the revolving loan fund is about a $68 million fund. We're asking for some more funds, but once that gets up to, we're in a long-range plan, once it got up to $100 million, that would take care of itself. It revolves. First, you got to have land. Then you got to have markets. And you got to have guys getting the land ready and producing it. It'll take care of itself.
Nevertheless, the budget requests for agriculture over the next 3 years total more than $46 million, including $38 million for loan programs and $8 million for roads and electricity. Farmers say while money to finance development is essential, they must have markets. Without markets for their grain, barley farmers say they won't plant additional acres.
And I have many thousand bushels of top quality number one and number two grain stored in my place. If I have no room to put any more grain into my bins next spring, as I have, I mean, they're full now, and I assume they will be next spring, I'm not going to plant. And there's no reason to get more product in my particular instance.
Except for a small in-state market for livestock feed, the grain reserve program remains the only significant market for Delta barley. But state agricultural planners say there may be a strong market for barley when the Point Mackenzie dairy industry gets underway. But the dairy industry's success depends on the success of the state's only milk processor, Matanuska Maid Dairy. Matanuska Maid is deep in bankruptcy and is being managed by the state to keep the business alive. Both the state and the farmers realize that if Matanuska Maid fails, the state's entire dairy industry and the barley project will fail also.
First, you got to go to Matt Maid. If they fail, we have no place to sell our milk to. If we have no place to sell our milk to, our dairy farmers are probably our biggest consumers of the Delta project. So I guess we're starting at the bottom. Right now, we've been working at the Matt Maid problem, and that is the foremost problem that we have right now.
Matanuska Maid and the barley farmers face a similar problem. They can produce a product, but it is not price competitive with imported goods. What happened to Matanuska Maid in the late 1970s and led to its current financial dilemma is similar to what has happened to the rest of Alaska's agriculture industry.
During the latter part of the 70s, we had a new freight line, a tote ship, came on board in the, I think it was about 77. They produced a competitive situation for Sealand. I feel that was really the beginning of a change in outside or foreign markets being able to penetrate into Alaska and effectively. Up until that time, there was nobody could come into Alaska and produce a product or ship a product in for the same price that could be manufactured here. But when those two shipping lines began to conflict and freight rates came down and stayed down for years, milk, dairy products were one of the items that were then expedited into this market at lower prices. That imported, or the foreign product as I call it, began to flow into Alaska freely at wholesale prices that were inexpensive, much lower than Matt Maid could afford to offer to the retailers. Can't blame the retailers. They were trying to be competitive with each other, and they accepted the product. They still carried Matt Maid, but it began to cut into Matanuska Maid's sales volume, began to have its effect on the dairy. The dairy began to lose money.
What does the bankruptcy of Matanuska Maid mean to the Point Mackenzie and Matanuska Valley dairy farmers? In part, lower milk prices and financial losses.
Right now, the producers are being forced into a situation that they cannot continue to sustain with the rationale that we have to sacrifice in order to make Matanuska Maid work. And I feel very strongly that there is no reason to sacrifice to make Matanuska Maid work if it's going to mean the sacrifice of all the individual farms. So we are kind of at a decision point what to do. And other than that, we have really little choice other than to try to get the price back up to where it has to be, regain control of the creamery and make it work.
With the state's entire milk and barley industry near collapse, the Division of Agriculture is recommending moratoriums on loan payments for some Delta and Point Mackenzie farmers. The division is also asking the governor and the legislature to bail Matanuska Maid out of bankruptcy. But according to one legislator, support may be conditioned upon assurances that the industry can be self-sufficient.
I think the legislative support will be there for agriculture if there is a some kind of a coherent plan, a program that will show how investment in agriculture will bring about the kind of agricultural production that will stand on its own feet sooner or later. You know, here we have a number of pieces floating around Delta, Mackenzie, Matanuska Maid, and unless all of them work together, and not just now, but in the long run, it's not going to be a viable process. So that I think that it's incumbent on the administration to have a serious program that shows how we deal with agriculture and how we protect the investment and the interests of the individual farmers. I think we have a responsibility to them.
Legislative support on a large scale may be more difficult to gain this time because of a management audit released by the State Office of Management and Budget on the Agricultural Revolving Loan Fund. The report concludes that management of the fund has been lax, resulting in a high rate of loan delinquency.
Well, the loan fund, in terms of delinquency, has a real problem in that we are nearly half of our loans are delinquent. Well, that doesn't mean that everybody is in a real bad farming situation. It may well be that the loan package was improperly constructed to start with and that we need to rewrite it so that we can get them back on a payback schedule that's compatible with their cash flow situation.
For the last 2 years, we've had a high, real high delinquency rate. We're kind of at the level off point now, and we're just starting to go down. Legislatures, when we go down to lobby for the revolving loan fund, that's the thing that they see most readily is our high delinquency rate.
It is clear that without an infusion of money, Alaska's agriculture industry will topple over like dominoes. First, Matanuska Maid Dairy would fall, then the Point Mackenzie Dairy Farms, and finally the Delta Barley Farms. But it is also clear that money alone will not solve all the problems that face Alaska's farmers. Agriculture is a marginal economic activity in the U.S. even in the best of times. Agriculture is especially marginal in Alaska, where weather is unpredictable, the growing seasons are short, the market small, and competition from imported products is fierce. It may be that Alaskans will have to decide what sort of agriculture they want to create, one which supplements the imported products, one which replaces imports, or a combination of both. Those who labor in the fields speak optimistically of their chances for success. They say developing Alaska's agriculture is all a question of time, money, and markets down on the farm.
The farmers have out there, they have a tremendous amount of enthusiasm towards agriculture and development of this thing. The enthusiasm seems to stop there.
I think that there is a real potential for agriculture in Alaska, but it will never be realized by people saying agriculture is good per se, that we must be self-reliant in agriculture. We never will be, we can't be, and we probably shouldn't be.
I think the state sometime needs to take a longer range view of what agriculture in Alaska will mean, not in 5 years, but what it'll mean in 20 years. It's something that, like I said before, it can't be built overnight. And
somebody's always reaching out there for that magic handle that's going to transform us into an agricultural state. That was the hope of the Hammond administration. That's baloney. It's not going to happen. You're not going to make Alaska an agricultural state. It's too far north. The climate is wrong. The soils may be great in spots, but the climate is wrong to make it a major competitive agricultural state.
Frankly, had we not had oil revenues of the magnitude we had at the time, it would have been a gamble that I personally would never have considered.